Well, good morning. It is so good to see everybody here on Graduate Recognition Sunday. We are glad you're here. Family and friends, make yourselves at home. I'll go ahead and do this just for our folks that are guests. If you need a restroom, there's one over here in the front. People are like, oh, I don't want to walk in front of everybody. That's okay. You can exit to the back. There's stairs that go downstairs, and the other bathroom's way down here on the other side in the basement. So it's up to you if you need a restroom, which way you may need to go. Just a few things to make you aware of this morning. Last Wednesday, we had our programs for our missions groups and our choirs. This Wednesday, we're actually going to do a combined mission project. So dinner will be at 5, and then at 5:30, all of our children's ministries will come together, and we have some mission projects that we're going to do together. So if you're working with either choirs or missions, we still need you here at 5:30. What time do we need you here? 5:30. All right. Thank you. All the kids know what time to be here. Adults, I hope that you can join us as well. We do have a few things coming up that you can read. We'll let you see those. But one thing we need some help with is Miss Evans at the high school reached out to us. One of the things that they've started doing with the senior class is tried to get a letter written from friends and family. And they also reached out to us. So we have some Sunday school classes that have joined in and helped participating with that. But outside on the front table, you'll see a list of students' names. If you could write one or two or three letters to the class, somebody said, what are we writing? We're writing words of encouragement. Let them know, kind of the way I wrote my letter was, we're glad that you're a part of the Bowdon community. We hope that you're always a red devil at heart. And what I close my letter with is, if I hope you always know that Bowdon Baptist Church will be here for you, and I'll be here for you. And so whatever you'd like to do, if you would just do me this favor, there's some note cards out there. You can write the students' names down. But if you would write out beside that student's name the letter that you were writing, so we'll be able to keep up with that. There are 103 in the graduating class. We've had about 60 of those already spoken for, so there's some that are still out there. So if you could do that, that would just help these students out to get some encouragement, not just from their friends and family, but from the community. And as we've talked all week about being engaged in our community, that'd be a great way for you to participate. I'll remind you at the end of the service to make sure you write your name down so we can get those names. Then also, if you're a guest with us this morning and you don't mind, in the pew in front of you, there should be a guest information card. If you would take that out and write down the information that's on that card for us, we would greatly appreciate it. We just like a record of your visit, and we're glad that you are here with us this morning. One of the things I love for us to do is just take an opportunity to fellowship with one another. So let's stand together, shake hands, hug necks, make everybody feel welcome at Bowdon Baptist Church this morning.
Continue to worship to the Lord together in prayer. God, thank you so much once again for the opportunity to come together today with family and friends and just the opportunity once again to speak of your great name. Lord, the way that you work in our lives, Lord, we cannot thank you enough. Lord, we just pray for our graduates once again today, knowing that you have a plan for their lives as you do for all of us. Lord, I just pray that we would honor them today. And thank you most of all, Lord, for what you've done for us. That we would honor you most of all in all that we do and all that we say today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hymn number 516. Thank you.
shame, every fear, every pain, live inside the dark, but that's not who we are. We are children of the day.
My name's Eric Lozano, and I'm graduating from Carrollton High School. I'm really thankful for my grandmother on my mama's side. She really helped me get through a lot that I really couldn't get through, and especially for my family, my second family that I'm with now. They helped me out a lot. They're the ones that actually brought me to this church and got me through a lot of hard times. My favorite verse is Jeremiah 29:11, and it's, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and to not harm you, plans to give you hope and future." I think what really got me with a strong relationship with Jesus was when I was struggling to decide what I wanted to do in my life and how everything's going to work out. And one night I just got on my hands and knees and prayed and asked, what should I do, and if he can help me, guide me through what I need to do with the rest of my life. And a couple of days later, an old man, when I was working at Hobby Lobby, actually came up to me and made it clear what I wanted to do after high school. I'm graduating from Carrollton High School, and the old man actually is the reason why I got my plans for after high school. I'm planning on going to the Marines after high school and become Marines Reserves for 6 years. And after that, I'm going to be getting my motorcycle mechanics and probably either Alabama University or I think it's just Alabama University.
So wake up, sleeper, lift your head. We were meant for more than this. Fight the shadows, conquer death. Make the most of the time we have left. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill.
My name is Katie Murcott, and I am graduating from Carrollton High School. I am thankful for my family, and mostly my mom. They've been there for me through a lot of hard times, and I know they'll always be there for me.
I do not have a specific favorite verse, but God has helped me through a fear of like being antisocial. He helped me get through that so that I can actually have a social life and I can actually talk to people without being afraid to.
I'm thankful for my grandmother and the impact she's had on my relationship with Christ. She pretty much led me to Christ through what she's done and just how she's been there for me.
I'm graduating from Carrollton High School and plan on going to the University of West Georgia to get my accounting degree and my economics degree so I can become an accountant.
We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine.
My name is Kenneth Fisher. I graduate from Bowdon High School. I am thankful for all the church members here to be my friends. I'm thankful for all my friends at school. One thing I learned about being here with youth at Bowdon Baptist is going to help my wife set up things. My favorite Bible verse is Matthew 6. Begin now, your kingdom's coming, you'll be done on earth as in heaven. After graduation, I'm going to be starting with ABM as a custodial worker at one of the schools here in Bowdon.
Let the light shine. We are called to spread the news, tell the world the simple truth.
My name is Danny Hernandez, and I'm graduating from Bowdon High School. I'm thankful for my family, not only my church family, but my real family, for helping me come to church and keeping me in church. I've learned that when I come to church, I have a family and I don't have to be alone, and that my church family is always going to be there for me.
I'm also very thankful for my salvation, and this is my favorite verse. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved.
My plans after high school are to get my AEMT certification and become a firefighter.
That Jesus came to save, there's freedom in his name, so let his love break through. We are the light of the world, we are the city on a hill, we are the light of the world.
Hey, my name is Alex Rodriguez, and I'm graduating from Carrollton High School. So, what I'm thankful for, or who I'm thankful for, is for all the people at this church that have worked hard for me to be able to learn a lot about Jesus, and to, you know, from simple things to giving me rides here and home to teaching me in Sunday school class, and just all the different things they do, such as activities and places we go for worship, and it's just, I'm really thankful for all that. All my years of being here at Bowdon Baptist, I think I've learned, like, 99% of the things of what's up here. So, but my number one thing would probably be how to be patient and understanding of people, especially during hard times and how things happen. And I don't know that's happening. So with some people, you just have to, like, give them some space and pray to God to help them. My favorite verse is 2 Chronicles 15:7. But as for you, be strong and do not give up, for your work will be rewarded. This verse kind of helps me in tough times whenever I'm working hard and kind of just feel like giving up if something's not working. Just I go and reread it and read some more things through 2 Chronicles, and it just helps me motivate myself to strive to the future. You know, graduating high school, my plans are to attend West Georgia and major in business management so I can, like, go into, like, corporate business and, well, manage. See how good I can be at making everybody in their different departments work together, and also in minoring in foreign language, so I can grow different businesses from different countries together, and hopefully get all that going good.
We gotta let the light shine.
Wisner, and I'm graduating from Harrison County High School.
I'm thankful for my family and the never-ending support that they give me, and I'm also thankful for my church family. As far as my youth group, I feel very comfortable, and, like, I have more family when I come here than I do anywhere else, and it's just really it's a blessing.
In my time here at Bowdon Baptist, the one thing I've learned throughout my youth and with the friends that I have in this church is that it only takes faith as small as a mustard seed to move mountains. And that speaks to me because no matter how much faith you really have, it only takes a little bit to make an impact in someone else's life or in your life. And that definitely is a life lesson that I need to carry with me.
My favorite Bible verse would be Psalms 34, verse 8. And it says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him." And that's my favorite just because it says, you know, the more that you trust in the Lord, the more blessed that you'll be in your life. And that's just a huge honor, and I'm thankful that I have God in my life to guide me through everything that I do.
After high school, I plan on going to West Georgia Technical College and studying the medical technician program.
So let your light shine brighter. We are the light, we are the light, we are the light. Jesus, you are the light, you are the light, you are the light. We will lift you high and shine, shine, shine.
My name is Anna Grizzard, and I'm graduating from Bowdon High School.
I'm thankful for my little family, Mama and Daddy and Sam, and all the support that they give me and everything that they've done for me. And I'm also very thankful for my church family and the support I find here and the love that we all share with each other and just the ability to come and worship every Sunday and Wednesday. I have learned through my relationship with Jesus and through my time at Bowdon Baptist that Jesus' love for me is unconditional. So regardless of where I fail in life or my shortcomings or what may happen, I can always find love in Jesus, and I will never be alone in the world.
My favorite verse is 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12. And it says, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, and in purity." And I like this verse because it just really encourages young people to be bold in their faith and just be a light in the world as they begin their journey. My plans for the future are to go to Auburn University and maybe double major in Spanish and early childhood education, and then minor in business. And yeah.
Let the light shine. Let the light shine. Let the light shine.
Blessing once again to share in this day with our graduates, and hopefully parents and others saw some pictures that you can maybe hold over your graduate's head. At this time, we're going to present a gift to our graduates, a Bible to take with them, and just a reminder of the fact of what they've learned here at Bowdon Baptist Church. If Pastor Justin can basically hand me a Bible as we go, and our graduates, if you can stand. I forgive you. Kenneth David Fincher. Y'all can applaud if you would like. Anna LaBeth Grizzard. Daniel A. Hernandez. Sorry, I do the hug stuff too. Eric Lozano. Katie Murcott. Alexandro Rodriguez. And finally, Kaylee D. Wisner. So thankful. Give our graduates a hand again. Obviously, there's a transition in their lives. Many would say maybe not as big of a transition as others and different things. But really, if you think about this, this is the first time once they go off to college or wherever they go that they will start to make their own decisions. And mom and dad will not be there. And so our prayer for them as they go or whatever they do, first of all, that they honor God. But also just the fact that they remember the fact of what they've learned. That Jesus goes with them as they go. And just something, a verse, as a prayer to them before we pray, just to remember this, is in Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. It says, "Therefore, as you receive Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him, rooted and built up in Him and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving." So they have the foundation. My prayer is that they will take that with them. And remember that foundation of Jesus Christ in their lives as the storms of life come and as the trials come. Let's pray for them together. Lord, I thank you once again so much for these graduates. Lord, I pray that once again that you would go before us, that you would go before them and prepare the way, prepare the path that you have for them. Lord, that they would honor you and follow you in their lives. Lord, that they would surrender to you in every way. Lord, we realize that this world and the enemy is against them. But Lord, we just pray that they would seek you, that they would stay connected and rooted in you and abide with you, knowing that you are their strength, you are their hope. So, Lord, I pray that for them this morning. And I just pray once again that you would bless them and the career paths that they might go for. Ultimately, Lord, that you would bless them in following you. And so, Lord, give them direction. And thank you for all that you do in our lives. In Jesus' name.
Boys and girls, let's have a children's sermon. Good morning. How are y'all? I know what you're probably wondering. Why does Anna Grizzard look like Judge Judy at church this morning? I'm going to explain it to you. Okay, when you're officially done with high school or your senior year, they have a ceremony, and you probably know about it. It's graduation. And what you do at graduation is you line up with all your friends, and you'll have on these black robes and these squares on top of your head, and you get a certificate, and it just means that you finished high school. It means you're done with all your school and you're ready for the next step in your life. A lot of big important things happen when you graduate high school or even before you graduate high school. And you have to make a lot of big decisions and you have to make a lot of big choices. I think my fellow graduates can attest to that. So I want to give you some tips on how to make good choices because I want to guide you and I want to help you know that you're making the right choices in life. So I have 5 tips. So if y'all can hold up your fingers, we're going to count together. Okay, we're on 1. Be patient. This is very hard for me, and I bet it's hard for some of y'all too, to be patient. But if we truly trust in God and who He is, then we have to trust in His timing. And sometimes God doesn't answer our prayers right when we ask Him to, but that doesn't mean He doesn't love us or that He's not listening. He just has a plan for us, and we have to trust in His timing. What number are we on, 2? Okay, thank you. Keep our eyes open. Sin and temptation are always going to be in the world. So we got to stay on our toes and we always got to be ready to overcome this and to do what Jesus would do. 3, pray without ceasing. And what that means is to never stop praying. And I don't ever want y'all to forget how awesome it is that the same God who created all this cool stuff like earth and outer space and pizza and ice cream, He made all that stuff. And He's so cool, and He wants to spend quality time with you. He wants to talk to you, and He wants to be alone with you, and He wants to listen to you and your problems, and He wants you to pray to Him and ask Him to guide you. He loves you so much. 4, read your Bible. The Bible is God's Word written directly on paper. I think I've told y'all this before. So I want to challenge you not only to read your Bible and to know it and to study it, but I want you to share it. I want you to share it with your friends and your family and all the people that you meet because that's the way we come to salvation. What number are we on? 5, make your decisions out of love. I'm going to read you a verse. It's 12:30. It says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your mind and with all your strength. Be bold in your love for God and allow it to guide you through some of your biggest life decisions. Now, I just want to tell y'all right quick that I am very, very proud of each and every one of you, and I love you so much. I'm so excited where God's going to take you because one day you'll be here and you're going to be making these big decisions. And I know that God has really big plans for y'all, and I'm very proud of you. So let's pray. Dear Lord, we are so thankful for all the blessings that you give us, God. We thank you for life. We thank you for this day. I thank you for every one of these children, God, and I just pray that you would guide them and you would put wisdom in their hearts, Lord, to make the decisions that they know are right for you. And we just love you so much, and we thank you. Amen.
Our offertory hymn is number 93, His Eye is on the Sparrow. I invite you to stand as we sing the first stanza only, number 93.
We come to you in thanksgiving, knowing all that we are and all that we have is a gift from you. We offer to you this day all aspects of our lives, whether it be at home or at work or at school, to be patient, to be merciful, to be generous, and to be holy. Give us the wisdom and insight to understand your will and the fervor to carry out your good intentions. We offer our gifts, time, talent, possessions to you as a true act of faith to reflect our love for you and our neighbor. Help us to reach out to others as you, our God, have reached out to us. Amen.
Thank you.
As we pray together this morning. Father, that's our heartbeat. Every time we gather together in this place is to see Jesus, to see Him high and lifted up. Father, I thank You so much for what we've already seen and what we've already heard this morning. And now we ask that as we look at Your Word, You would speak to our hearts and minds. As always, help us not just to be hearers, but to be doers. Father, when we leave from this place, that we would be different because we have seen Your Son. Father, have Thy will be done in this place, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and be turning to Genesis chapter 25. We know that the Holy Spirit is in this. I explained last week that I didn't know who was supposed to be preaching on the last day of the month of April. And we figured out, oh, AJ's going to that night, but somebody's got to do the morning, and that was still my responsibility. So as we were sitting in staff meeting, we were planning on what we were going to be preaching. AJ said, well, I'm going to preach on choices. I said, isn't that interesting? Because about 6 months ago when I was planning for this Sunday, I was going to preach on choices too. But go ahead, since the Lord's leading you to preach on choices, you go right ahead because you're going first. But I'm still going to preach on choices. Amen? We know that the choices that we make have lasting impact. AJ looked at Abraham and Lot and the choices that, Abram and Lot, and the choices that they made and how that influenced generations of people. The passage we'll look at, passages plural we'll look at this morning, the same. Because of the choices that Jacob and Esau made, it affected generations. So if you will, begin with me in Genesis chapter 25. We'll begin reading in verse 19. We'll kind of set the stage, get a little bit of a background. It says, these are the generations of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham fathered Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah, the daughter of Bethuel, the Aramean of Paddan Aram, the sister of Laban, the Aramean, to be his wife. And Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord granted his prayer. And Rebekah, his wife, conceived. The children struggled together within her, and she said, if it is thus, why is this happening to me? So she went and inquired to the Lord, and the Lord said to her, two nations are in your womb, and two people from within you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other, and the older shall serve the younger. When her days were to give birth were completed, behold, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all of his body like a hairy cloak. So they called his name Esau. And afterward, his brother came out with his hand holding Esau's heel. So he was called Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. Verse 27, when boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man dwelling in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he ate of his game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. As we look at this setup for choices, I want you to understand in this whole process that God is the one who guides. God is the one who directs. He sets the stage right off the bat for us to understand that He is sovereign. One of our students quoted Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. The Lord has a plan. For every single one of us, there is a plan. A plan for us to prosper. A plan for us to be blessed by Him. And a lot of times His plan and our plan, they just don't match up. Because it says right here that God spoke to Rebekah and said, one shall be stronger than the other, but the older shall serve the younger. That doesn't make sense in that culture. The firstborn has the birthright. The firstborn gets all the blessing. All the other subsequent children, they just don't matter. All the firstborn in the room said what? Amen. That's right, right? All the firstborn, the older children, that's right. We get all the blessing. We get all the good stuff, right? That's the way that it was in that culture. That the firstborn got all the good stuff. And yet God speaks and says, the older shall serve the younger. There was a plan. You know, it's amazing to watch, even in our choices, that God continues to work His plan. And we've got to decide right off the bat if we believe that God is God and that He is sovereign and that His way is right. Because if you don't believe that, the rest of this is not going to make sense. The reality is the rest of your life is not going to make sense if you don't start foundationally by saying, God, You are sovereign, You are in charge, and whatever happens down the road, whatever goes on, wherever we go, whatever decisions we make, You're already there and You know the decisions and that You're going to guide, You're going to direct, and You have a plan. If you believe that, then everything else that happens makes sense. If you don't believe that, you're going to live a life that is in chaos at all times. Because bad things are going to happen. We had the conversation last week. I encourage you to watch the video. A lot of you had comments back and forth with me on social media about Vody Bachum's sermon, or just the brief part of his sermon, where he talked about what happens when bad things happen to good people. And then he really reversed the question, said you've got to ask the question, why would God allow good things to happen to anybody? When we are sinners and we've turned our back on God, why would He bless us? That's probably a better way to ask the question. So we need to understand that God is in charge and that He has a plan. Paul reminded us of this in Romans chapter 9, in verses 10 through 12. And not only so, but when Rebecca had conceived children by one man, our forefather Isaac, though they were not yet born and done nothing either good or bad, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, God's plan, not because of the works, but because of Him who calls, she was told the older will serve the younger. So we see this connection, Old Testament, New Testament. And then in verse 13, as it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. There's a lot of theologies wrapped up in that statement. You won't have that conversation in Sunday school next week. Enjoy that. I don't want it to hijack our thinking this morning, but we have to ask ourselves the question, do we trust God's sovereign plan in our life? Do we trust Him in the plan that He has for us? So the first thing we want to look at is this bad choice that we see Esau make. In chapter 25, verses 29 through 34, the story is told of the first bad choice. Once when Jacob was cooking stew, Esau came in from the field. He was exhausted. Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stew, for I'm exhausted." Therefore his name was called Edom, because he liked red stew. Jacob said, "Sell me your birthright now." Esau said, "I'm about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me now." So he swore to him, and he sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. I wonder from that moment on, did Esau despise red stew? Every time he saw red stew, it came back to him that he had sold his birthright for a bowl of stew. And this is where we start thinking and understanding. And I'll go ahead and confess, I was asked the question even Saturday morning, do preachers double dip? Like, do we preach the same sermon over again? Well, if you come to baccalaureate service, let me go ahead and tell you, you're going to hear this one again. Because you see one decision impacting the entire trajectory of Esau's life. From then on, because he was in a moment of passion, in a moment of emotional decision-making where he wasn't processing, as we were encouraged this morning in the children's sermon, that we need to run that through the filter of God's Word when we make those decisions, that we need to pray continually. That's a good sermon outline. Okay, all right, thanks. If we don't use that as a filter to make the decisions that we're making, and I get it, it's hard for 17, 18, 19-year-olds to make wise decisions. I get it. I remember being 17, 18, and 19, and I was stupid. We found out that's biblical this week. The proverb says, because I don't listen to wisdom, I am stupid. I can say stupid now, Jill. It's in the Bible. She told me I couldn't say stupid because she didn't want her kids saying stupid, because SpongeBob said stupid. But now the Bible says stupid. Yeah. I know, because I am stupid. Because I don't listen to wisdom, I am stupid. And I make dumb decisions. We need to understand that those singular decisions can impact us forever. I was trying to think through the best decision, all these others. I'll just throw me under the bus. I have a scar on my back. That's about that long. I don't ever see it. It's about that long. But it's still there, and it's because I made a bad decision. All right? When I was a kid, we had a chicken coop. And it was attached to this little corn barn that was down on my grandpa's property. And I thought it'd be fun to slide off that onto the top of the chicken coop. And my sister had done it, and the neighbor's kids had done it. And they were doing it. It looked like a lot of fun. So we're just sliding down the top of the roof. I'm a little bit bigger than most kids. I don't know if you've noticed that. They were sliding off and they weren't having any problems. Well, I slid off and get on the chicken coop and stand up. And guess what happens to the chicken wire? yet turned loose. And it wasn't just like the round chicken wire. I think it was made out of, I don't know, kryptonite. Because when it broke, it sliced me up my back. It's like, oh, I'm bleeding. So I go in and I made a bad decision. Well, then my mom, she still feels bad about this to this day. Because when I was telling her about this scar, she was like, yeah, I still feel bad that I didn't take you to the hospital and get that sewn up. So not only did I make a bad decision, then my mom made a bad decision. So every time I go to the pool at Rockridge, all the kids are like, ooh, what happened to you? And I go all kinds of places. Yeah, I had to have a kidney removed. And they're like, oh, really? I was like, no. I got shot in the back. And they're like, no, I'm just... So you guys know how much fun we're going to have with this one this year at the pool, right? So because I made a bad decision and because my mom made a bad decision and the bad choice, the reality is that's always there. Like I can feel it right now. It doesn't hurt or anything, but I know it's there. Now that's very innocuous. Big deal. There's a scar on your back, Justin. But David said it this way in Psalm 51 when he was confronted with sin. What? My sin is ever before me. Esau's decision was always there. And I want to commend our graduates for making some good decisions. You got here. Like you finished the course. You completed the task. You guys have friends and students that didn't. Like they quit. They gave up. And they're like, I'm not going to finish the drill. I'm not going to complete the task. Let's look at the second bad choice real quick. Turn over to chapter 27. This one wasn't Esau's, it was Jacob's poor decision. His brother. Verse 35, but he said, your brother came deceitfully. He's taken away your blessing. His mom said, go in there and put some hair on you and make some stew and take it to your dad. And if you'll take it to your dad, he'll give you his blessing. So the birthright's one thing, and now the blessing was going to come from the father. And his mom says, I want you to be deceitful. I want you to live up to your name. I want you to be Jacob. I want you to be the supplanter. I want you to be the heel grabber. What was God's plan? This is crazy. When you start looking at the sovereignty of God and how all this works out, I'm telling you, you want to sit and have a conversation, have a conversation around that verse. Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. Go in there and I want you to pretend to be your brother so you can be blessed. And Esau comes in and goes to do the same thing because his father had asked for some game to be prepared. And he loved to eat Esau's food. As soon as Esau, in verse 34, heard the words of his father, he cried out with exceeding great and bitter cry and said to his father, bless me, even also my father. But he said, your brother came deceitfully and has taken away your blessing. And Esau said, is he not rightly named Jacob? For he's cheated me these two times. He took away my birthright. Well, now he's taken away my blessing. Then he said, have you not reserved a blessing for me? And Isaac said to Esau, behold, I've made him lord over you and all your brothers. I've given him for servants and with grain and wine. I've sustained him. What then can I do for you, my son? And Esau said to his father, have you not but one blessing, my father? Bless me even also, my father. And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. And Isaac, his father, answered him and said, behold, away from the fatness of the earth shall your dwelling be, and away from the dew of heaven on high. By your sword you shall live, and you shall serve your brother. When you grow restless, you shall break his yoke from your neck. Now Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing with which his father had blessed him. Esau said to himself, the days of mourning for my father are approaching, then I will kill my brother Jacob. Esau made a bad decision. He lost his birthright. Jacob makes a bad decision, and now his brother wants to kill him. The crazy part about reading the scriptures, so many times we see the negative and we don't want to get to the positive. So many times people say, oh, if God's a God of love and God is God of this and God, like, he's God. Like, he's righteous and he's holy and he's just. And even when we make bad decisions, you know, God blesses us even in the midst of making bad decisions. But now Jacob is on the run, and you read the story, the rest of the story up until chapter 32, and Jacob is basically run away from his brother Esau, that relationship has been destroyed. I wonder in this room how many of us have relationships that have been restored because of the bad decisions that we've made. And we think that there is no hope for restoration. I want to give you a little transition, what I love about the Scripture. And those of you that have been here on Sunday night, as we've studied through the Old Testament, you see this, right? We see this curse. We see the bad choices. We see the nation of Israel over and over again choosing to reject God. And yet God continues to bring them back and restore them and discipline them and get them to a place of blessing. So it does not come as a surprise to us that God would do the same thing in the life of His people, and specifically Jacob and Esau. But to get to chapter 33, we need to get the end of 32. Something happens. Look at the end of chapter 32 with me. Same night he arose, talking about Jacob and his two wives, two female servants, 11 children. They crossed the ford of the Jabbok. Mary took them and sent them across the stream and everything else he had. And Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until the break of day. The man saw he did not prevail against Jacob. He touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, "Let me go, for the day is broken." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And he said to him, "What's your name?" He said, "Jacob." Then he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." And Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it you ask my name?" There he blessed him, and Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life has been delivered." God does not reject Jacob at the point of him stealing the birthright. He doesn't reject Jacob for taking away the blessing. We know that we read the rest of the Old Testament. It talks about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That God changes the name of Jacob here from Jacob to Israel, the father of the nation of Israel. But there's something that takes place in Jacob's life, and I think needs to happen to every single one of us, is that we need to see the face of God. Thank you, choir, for singing that powerful line, that we would see Jesus revealed in the preaching of His Word. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. If you will see Jesus on display in the Scripture for who He is, not who the culture says He is, not we as religious people say He is, what the Scripture says Jesus is and who He is, the one who gave His life for ransom for our sin. Jacob saw God. And then what happens in chapter 33? Jacob's out there and he hears Esau is coming with all of his people. Here comes Esau, and Jacob is terrified about what's going to take place. He's like, "Oh, it's coming now. He said he was going to kill me. It's going to happen. Here it comes." Look at verse number 4. "But when Esau ran to meet him, and embraced him and fell on his neck and kissed him, and they wept." God can overcome our bad choices. Don't misunderstand that. God has a sovereign plan for your life. I share way too much about my own personal life, but I will share it again this morning because I think it will help. Have I already confessed this morning I was stupid? Anybody, did I say it? I was stupid. And especially when it came to relationships. Every relationship I got into from the time I was 13 until I got married was I would go on a date, and the next day I'd be in love, and I'd call or I'd write a note, say, "I love you. I love you so much." And I would treat that relationship like we were married. And that would last, I don't know, 6 weeks, 6 months, whatever it was. And then we'd break up. I'd be all heartbroken and tore up and all that kind of stuff. And then guess what? I'd find another one. And I'd be in love with her about 2 or 3 days later, a week later. "I love you. You love me. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We love. And then we'd go into that cycle again. We was in love, right? Oh, dear Lord. So then when I was in college, I was We've established this, and it's been confirmed. Dudes don't get their brain till 26, right? That's what we finally decided, not 25. Dudes don't get their brain till 26. So ladies, look, I'm just, until he's 26, no brain. I'm living proof of that because I thought that I'd found the one. And we started making plans to get married. And I bought her a ring and gave it to her. And I thought I was going to spend the rest of my life with this person. And God's like, oh, Justin, you've made another bad choice. Let me help you out. And so we had a conversation one night. And I realized that she was not the one for me. And God had to deliver me from that bad choice. Because I was headed down the wrong path. You realize what could have happened to me if I progressed in that relationship and married this person, and that was not the person that God had. He intervened, interceded in my life. Does it always happen that way? No. A lot of us go through and make dumb decisions, and God continues to bless us and continues to guide us and continues to direct us. And what did God do? In the midst of me being stupid, He delivered me. He blessed me. And all you have to do is look on the back row of the choir, that beautiful black curly hair. And you know God's blessed me, amen? And most of y'all know Miss Jill, know it's beyond the external. She is a Proverbs 31 woman. That was my stupidity, and God overcame that. Understand, ladies and gentlemen, and especially our graduates, understand. Like, make the right choices. Do the right thing. But understand that God has a plan for you. Everybody in here's made bad choices, amen? Oh, wait a minute. I'm sorry. Let me try that again. Let me help. Everybody's going to say amen right here, so let me preface you. Everybody in here's made bad choices, amen? All right, I was going to say there's a couple of liars in here. Everybody's made bad choices. And the reality is some of us are living with those scars of our bad choices, and they'll always be there. But we have a God who's a God of restoration. And even those broken relationships, God can restore. But it comes when we come into a right relationship with Him. We don't know what Esau did to get his life all straightened out. All we know is that when Jacob sees Esau, he looks at Esau and he says, it's like I've seen the face of God. When I look at my brother Esau, well, he had just seen the face of God. And he looks at his brother and says, like I've seen the face of God. I've been restored. Everything's been made right. So the question that we have to ask ourselves is, do we believe that God will restore our relationships when we turn back to Him? That even though we make those bad decisions, that God can fix it if we'll turn back to Him. Jacob wrestled with God. He saw Him face to face, and he made a turnaround, because when he saw his brother, what did he do? He ran to him, embraced him, loved him. Even though they had been through a lot of stuff, that relationship had been restored. But church, it only is restored when we turn our hearts and minds back to the Lord. Let's pray together this morning. Father, I thank You for the truth of Your Word, and I thank You for these redemption stories. Father, we know, as we learned even Sunday night, that when people make bad decisions, that they are destructive. We watched Lot's, almost his entire family, be destroyed because he not only set his tent towards Sodom, but then he's living in Sodom. And Father, we see even today that Jacob and Esau made bad choices. But Father, You had a divine sovereign plan for their lives. But that relationship was restored when they turned to You. Father, there are some men and women, some boys and girls that need to turn their lives back to You this morning. You've already been at work in their heart. Now they're here. Now they know why. Because they know they need to turn to You. So I pray for that man, woman, boy, or girl that's here that needs that relationship, that they would turn back to You. Father God, I pray for those of us that have been reminded today of our bad choices. Maybe just we
We've never dealt with it. We need to confess and we need to repent today. But whatever it is, Father, our end game, our end goal is restoration, not just with people, but ultimately with You. Father, that comes through that relationship with Your Son. So I pray for everyone here that we would make sure that that relationship is right. And that You'll receive the glory and the honor for it. We pray in Jesus' name. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, if you'll quietly stand your feet, ask Brother Benny to come. He's going to lead us in a song of invitation. And all that means, we start singing in a minute. You've got questions about God's Word, about what we've talked about. You know you need Christ. I'm going to be down front. You come and share with me what God's dealing with in your heart and life. We want you to respond to the truth of God's Word, as James tells us, not just to be hearers, but to be doers. So wherever it is God's speaking to your heart, be obedient to Him as we sing in just a moment. Father, as always, our prayer is Your will be done. We thank You in advance that it is. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Benny, what number are we going to sing this morning?
434.
Making the most important decision you can ever make. Let's sing about it this morning together. Maybe this is the place that you sense God is working in your life and you need to be a member with us. We thank the Lord for those that He's added to our number over the last few months. Maybe God's been dealing with you and this is the place you need to be a member. We invite you to join with us today by letter, statement, or baptism as we sing this verse together. Lives. I thank you for the friends and family that have invested to get these guys and girls where they are today. Lord, we want to pray that what's been instilled in them, invested in them, will carry them down the road. And Father, You will use all this investment to make a difference in them as they go. Father, help us to continue to pray for them, encourage them, and strengthen them. It's just the next step. Father, I pray that they all know, no matter what happens down the road, no matter what decision they make, Bowdon Baptist Church loves them. Father, let them know their pastor loves them. No matter what, we'll always be. Father, we thank You that we can celebrate with them today, that we can honor them today, and one of the ways that we do that is to gather around the table and fellowship. We ask that in just a moment after the choir sings and after the graduate process, we can all go downstairs together and just celebrate the accomplishments of these young men and ultimately give You the glory for all that's been accomplished. We ask that in prayer. Please stand for just a moment. A couple of things that we need to do as we transition to
close. To me, to
choir is going to sing a blessing.
May the wind blow at Your back. May the sun shine warmly on Your face. Until we meet again.